When Hamlet, the Prince of Denmark's father, dies in some rather obscure circumstances, and his widowed mother gets married to his uncle within a few months of the king's death, he becomes melancholic with contemplations of suicide. Out of those ruminations comes one of the most popular soliloquies of all time, when Hamlet says, "To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing end them, to die, to sleep, no more." Such thoughtful reflections upon the wretchedness of life is often considered to be a trait of humans and humans alone. But as the study of evolution and genetic configuration of animals has brought about conclusive evidence of innumerable similarities between other animals and us, we're left to ponder if other animals are also capable of having suicidal thoughts, or not simply to think upon them, but to act to kill themselves as well. In order to kill oneself, one has to first know oneself, that is, have a degree of recognition of the I who's doing all the thinking. Though there is always an impregnable barrier between the state of a person who's not thinking of suicide and the one just before the act of suicide, there is no denying that the suicidal person is thinking about him or herself, and how the act of taking one's own life might ease their pain, or have an altruistic effect on a society, or satiate one's curiosity of knowing what lies beyond death, something that Hamlet dubbed to be the undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveller returns. Some animals, to various degrees, are shown to have some awareness of themselves. One of the ways to know this is by a test that was developed by Gordon Gallup Jr., known as the mirror test. In a conventional mirror test, an animal is either colored or has a sticker attached to some part of the body when anesthetized. When the animal wakes up, a mirror is placed close by. If the animal then touches the mirror to examine the portion of his body to investigate the marked portion, it is thought to be examining its own self, rather than any other animal. Only a handful of animals, such as Asiatic elephants, dolphins, the great apes, orcas, and European magpies, have passed this test. Apart from this test, the distinction that animals carve between their own scent or songs and that of other animals is also a pretty good indicator that animals are self-aware. But being aware of I is not sufficient condition to suffice that animals can commit suicide. There's always the question of whether the animals had the intent of committing suicide. And how can we know about the intent of other animals when their subjective experiences are so alien to us? Take a bat, for example. We can know about their echolocating practices, their ability to fly, their nocturnal nature, their internal mechanisms of warding off viruses with ease, and know as human beings how these work in totality. But as Thomas Nigel put it in one of his brilliant essays, it would be wholly impossible to know what it's like for a bat to be a bat. Perhaps drawing a parallel out of that, we can very well ask the question, we have a faint understanding of what it's like for a human to commit suicide, but what would it be like for an animal to commit suicide? There have been a few reports of some animals committing suicide. One of them was as early as 1932, when in a zoo in England, it was reported by the zookeeper that a monkey took a rope, made a noose at one end, tied the other one to a tree, and jumped neck first over the noose and was instantaneously killed. Even Jane Goodall, the world's premier expert on chimpanzees, once reported how, after the death of the mother Flo, Flint lost the will to live as his mother couldn't nourish him to independence before her death. But in both of these cases, are the zookeeper and Jane Goodall becoming a tad anthropomorphic? That is, assigning human-like qualities such as misery, depression, etc. to these animals when they really aren't. An example of human anthropomorphism in god worship was given by a Greek poet who once famously remarked that if oxen and lions had hands and could paint with their hands and produce works of art as men do, horses would paint the forms of gods like horses and oxen like oxen. So the Ethiopians make their gods black and snub-nosed, the Thracians give theirs red hair and blue eyes. So when talking about animal suicide, are we anthropomorphic in assigning non-existing qualities to animals? Recent studies in animal behavior have shown that even non-human animals are capable of pining over loved ones, are capable of being irritable or being provoked to aggression. So the flat out denial that animals don't really have any human-like qualities is coined as anthropodenial, the utter negation of the possibility of human-like traits in non-humans. Some animals have been documented to undergo some ritualistic behaviors where once a horde of elephants veered off their tracks to visit the bones of a deceased elephant and circled around them and eventually retraced to their original path. Besides, in an award-winning documentary called The Cove, an animal activist claimed that a dolphin, after a life in captivity, had committed suicide by willingly not breathing. Given that dolphins have a rich tapestry of motivational states that allow them for complex thoughts, thanks largely to their large and complex brains, the possibility of its suicide cannot be completely ruled out. Further, unlike human beings who drown in seas because they have an involuntary breathing systems, dolphins possess a remarkable ability to breathe only when they will, meaning that they can hold out their breaths indefinitely with a conscious decision. But how conscious was the dolphin in not taking the breath? Or was it wholly under the neurobiological impulses and had no choice but to not breathe? We do not know. So, while contemplating about non-human animal suicide, there is a lot to learn. We know so little about one of the most harrowing diseases that is a precursor to a lot of suicide in human beings, that is depression. A doctor once said that if we compare our knowledge of depression to Columbus's discovery of America, we're still in the little island of the Bahamas, and the whole of America is still to be uncovered. Given that we know so little about human suicides, despite it being a subject which has been hotly debated and studied for centuries, we don't even know what we know or don't know about non-human suicides. Such a state of ignorance about the subject was once captured beautifully by Henry Beston in his imperishable The Outermost House, where he remarked that in a world older and more complete than ours, they move finished and complete, gifted with the extension of senses we have lost or never attained, living by voices we shall never hear. They are not brethren, they are not underlings, they are other nations caught with ourselves in the net of life and time, fellow prisoners of the splendor and travail of the earth. And like our fellow prisoners, we too are hostages to our own ignorance about their subjective experiences, their free will or the absence of it, or their willingness to commit suicide. Perhaps the answer to this question can be addressed with some relative degree of confidence in the decades to come. For now, there is much we do not know, and what we know dwarfs in comparison to what we don't.